Since the mast has been installed outside the pub, there are 10 medical cases out of 15 houses that are closely, including myself. There have been 3 deaths and 3 cases of cancer. So as a minimum, I ask that the decision be delayed, if not rejected, on the basis that further investigations are needed in view of that information and in view of an outstanding response from the government on this particular matter. And I'd also ask, just as a rhetorical question, how many of the planning committee would move to a house in that particular location?
Okay, thank you, Mr. Evans. Thank you very much. So I think, Jerry, do you want to come forward again? Mr. Evans, can you just move back and let Jerry come forward now, please? Thank you very much.
Thank you again.
Colleagues,
I'm really concerned about this application. I know that we've all got mobile phones and we all want better quality reception. But maybe, as the speaker, just Mr. Evans, just said a few minutes ago, must be better sites nearby. And if these developers, these mobile phone companies could make a bit more effort, they might have actually found a more suitable site. The fact is that I'm not too sure actually that this previous application was actually approved. My memory is, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, my memory is that this application was actually refused last one. And because of some sort of administrative error within the department, it actually was allowed to go ahead. So I'm not quite sure that we're actually looking at a previous approval. I'd like to hear the officer's view on that later in a moment when I'm finished. But if you look at the planning history, it says that the last application was refused, and yet there it is. How did that come about? Well, that's by the way. This mast will shoot up to some, in old language, which I understand better, 53 feet, quite a high mast, about 53 feet. I think it would become a bit of a blot on the landscape, more of a blot on the landscape as it is. So I'm asking if the committee would refuse it on the grounds of it being its obtrusive nature. But the other matter is one of concern. This might not be well known in the area, but as Mr. Evans has said, there seems to be a pattern of local illness and cancer in that area. Now, obviously, I can't say how related they are, but a number of people well above the normal average seem to be going down with illnesses. And I would have thought that you, like me, could all be concerned about that fact. Maybe we could get somebody to, we could defer this decision and try and find out if there is actually a cluster of cancerous illnesses in that area. So, also, it hasn't been mentioned yet, the officer didn't mention it in their report, that there's a children's playground only a few metres away from the thing, and you've got children running around there all the time from 4 to 3:30 in the afternoon and all over the weekend out on holidays. And I'm just a bit concerned, I know the Stewart report did give some guidelines on this, and I'm just concerned that it may well be that this is too close to the children's playground, which is nearby. There is, of course, right underneath it almost is the garden, the pub garden, the big garden of the pub. And they do have children sitting out in the beer garden with the parents. So I'm very concerned about the potential health risks. Very concerned also about the obtrusive height of 53 foot mast. And at the very least, I would ask if you would defer this decision until we get more information about the health of the people in the area. And thanks for listening to me again.
Thank you, Jerry. We're just going to clear up a couple of issues that Jerry brought to bear. So we'll go to Matthew first and then I'll come.
Can I just confirm that this mask is not one of the four that went through because decisions were not issued in time back in 2006, 2007. It's not one of those masks. The history, the planning history clearly shows that the mask has had approval. Just to pick up on the issue of health, the 2013 regulations, the government has already said that health considerations should be taken into consideration when determining applications of this type. So it isn't something that you would be able to refuse an application of.
Okay, Stuart's in number four. Then you two.
I think as I read the application, if you were to refuse the application, then presumably a mask of 14.8 metres would remain in place. I don't claim to be a radiation scientist or anything, but I am aware that the higher or further away you are from source radiation, the so-called index square will apply, in other words, the amount of radiation you are exposed to will reduce in twice the proportion. Twice the inverse proportion of the distance. So actually, if we're concerned about health, making it taller makes it safer, in fact. But I'm not personally convinced about the health effects of the masks. I might be more convinced about the health effects of that than a stick right next to me at, at least two of the occasions there. That's probably not taking health. But the mask itself, I think the addition of 2 meters is a marginal increase on what it is, and we get some mass share in houses, which presumably means that we're not having another mass in the area, so another operator can get the same coverage as a competitor.
Thanks, Jeff. Following that, can I get some clarification on the application? Because I see that in 2010 an application was approved for a mask with dual use, so that was Vodafone and O2, so it is currently operated by those two. So this isn't, we're not saving the mask here, we're not preventing the mask being created elsewhere, are we?
Through you, Chair. In the sense that to upgrade the performance of the mask visibility, you would have to have different masks if you didn't combine it all in one place. So yes, they are already sharing, and they will still share this particular mask, and you'll have, instead of two masks for two different sets of antennae, you'll still have one, will be the bigger antenna to facilitate the extra broadband network.
If I can just go back to that, Chair, because I remember this original application, because I think about for refusal then, because I did attach the sort of the visual amenity element, if you like, I did attach a lot of weight to that argument, the fact that it would damage the visual amenity to residents. And I must say, I do frequent that area fairly often because of the public house behind it, I might say. And I have actually visited that public house very recently. I have an O2 mobile telephone, and I have 4G capability in that public house. So I do worry when we as an authority seem to accept the arguments of these telephone companies that, oh, we need this extra 2 metres, because without that, then there wouldn't be any more high-speed broadband in that area. I mean, that argument there, anecdotally, is just completely false. I didn't support it last time because of the effect on visual amenity. I think a further 2 metres does have a further detrimental impact on visual amenity, so I'll be opposing the application.
Any other comments? The recommendation is for approval. Does anybody want to move approval? Stuart, thank you. Anybody want to second that? Thank you, Phil. Let's go to the vote. So the vote is for approval. All those in favour of approving, can you please show? And against? Right, that's approved. Thank you very much. Thank you. table number 5, please. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Chair. This application is by Foley Golf Club. The proposals are to reinstate and maintain the works of existing rock arm on Elizabeth Fence along the coast adjacent to the golf club. The proposals are on the green belt and the site's designated for landscape value and various habitat and species designations. Consideration should be given to the visual appearance and the impact on designated species and landscape. The existing rocks that were there to provide defences were approved in the 1980s. Over time, they've worn away. It weakens the defence of the cliff, defence of being eroded. The proposal involves the import of rock to supplement and tidy up the existing rock armour. There is the extent of the coastline, which is the golf course, that has a rock on, but we also have our Ellis Council on the side of it, which we provide. As the proposal involves the import of rock to supplement the existing rock that's there to take off on from the beach what's been eroded away, put it back, fix it up. It will involve some storage of rock at either end of the site during the process. And it will involve access to the site from either end of the site, or predominantly from Croft Drive, where the proposal to create new access through the golf club down to the beach. The principle has been established with the existing rock arm up defences that are there, and can be regarded as appropriate development in the green belt. The habitat assessment has been carried out when this application was received, and concludes that there is no harm to wildlife resulting from the proposal, providing it's carried out with the mitigation measures that are suggested and the conditions that are suggested as part of this report. It is recommended for approval.
Thank you. Any comments?
Yeah, I move approval.
Okay, thank you very much. Second to Phil, all those in favour? Yeah. 13 unanimous, thank you very much.
Thank you, Chair. This is an application for a single-storey rear extension. The proposal measures 3 metres deep where it's adjacent to the boundary of the adjoining property and has stepped away from the boundary to a distance of 3.8 metres. This complies with the Council's house extension policy and will not have an adverse impact on the adjacent property. We have had two objections in relation to this proposal, one from the adjoining property who were concerned particularly because works had begun without planning permission. Had works not been done without planning permission, this could be something we regard as permitted development to the residential, the extension to permitted development. The other objections from the other side of the road and just again expressing concern that works have started. It does comply with the policy and it is recommended for approval.
Any comments?
This would
be recommended for you, if you don't know. Mr. Stewart, so you sign in second. So, Stewart. Can we stand a second? All those in favour, please. Thank you very much. I think it's last but not least, number 9.
Thank you, Chair. This is an application which not going to be brought to committee. It's a prior approval for a larger extension, which is now planned to development for a limited period of time. Fulfills the criteria that we've normally expected to. It's a relatively small and larger extension, and we've had no objections to it, we've received no objections to it.
Okay, somebody to move, thank you, and second, thank you very much, Christine. All those in favour? Okay, thank you very much. Then, if you want to tell Simon to take it from back in.
Discussing facing the issue, Matthew those would be taken into account by the inspector, and where we do not, presumably we can now take things on its merits. I just wanted to ask now, you know, obviously spokesperson and the officers are listening, it would care to me, it would probably better either suspending or abandoning the policy, so that we have no policy with which we can be embarrassed by, and await the production of a new one. And I don't know what the process is, but what I do know is it is far too extreme for planning visits to have policies in which planning committee has no confidence in. And can I also just second what David said about the way he handled that, given that it was a very embarrassing and difficult situation for all of us involved.
Through you, Chair, it isn't really something that the planning committee could decide. It's a change in policy, so it would have to be a council decision. The council is, as I said, it's moving through the process of reviewing its planning policies anyway, with a view to having a public inquiry towards the back end of this year. Well, the core strategy and all the other planning policies that we're currently working towards will be tested and subject to that review. But we can take some additional advice, I think, from planning policy colleagues about where we are in terms of that specific policy and process that we need to apply moving forward.
Okay, can the planning committee, do you think you're only going to find out if the planning committee can actually add to that or have a comment on that, have a say in that? Because as we say, we've been embarrassed, but we found ourselves in situations where there's policies that we as a committee find difficult to understand and upheld, so would we be able to have some input into that to respond?
The process for the core strategy now, the local development framework as a whole, so the core strategy which will form the council's new planning policies around key areas and will be supported by a host of supplementary planning documents and other supplementary documents will start to work through the process. It's been through a period of public consultation. The comments have been taken on board. Things have been amended, it's been through consultation again, but before it goes to inquiry, there will be an opportunity for members of the planning committee to have an input into what those policies say and how it's moving forward.
Thank you, Chair. Just a very quick one. Could we have something limited at this meeting to the effect that the members were concerned about the way the current department of is having an adverse impact on some of the applications we're trying to approve, and we'd like to see the whole issue formally considered in the future. And just have it on the minutes, we'll then make sure to get lost in the ether somewhere. I think that's important, Chair, that it's limited in that way.
Okay, thank you.
Andy.
Thank you, Chair. I think David's put it over quite well, but we must remember that we've only got one more planning meeting with this committee. Because it could well change, we could all be changed. I'd certainly like to make sure that the next planning committee know what's actually happened this evening and we can go through the procedures so we're not going to have another hiccup.
Thank you, Jim. That evening, Kate Stewart has worked on the abandoned law. That's the
With respect, I wasn't talking about the process of having new policies in place. I was talking about the process of finding the policies that we thought we had. Now, I hear the answer that we can't suspend it. I guess you went to the council rather than the cabinet's decision. I think what I was after was, what is the process to put the matter before the council in terms of abandoning that policy prior to the court that's going on. It's clearly allocated, it clearly doesn't enjoy any support.
It's Through you, Chair, members will recall that not last year, the year before, the council revoked the interim housing policy for housing. That was a council decision. There was a report that was taken to council advising that that policy be revoked and no longer form part of council policy. That a similar process would need to be applied. We would have to take a report to council suggesting that SPD 4B permanently revoked. But given that we're already moving through the process of reviewing that policy anyway, with the likelihood that it will form a material consideration for planning decisions in the very near future, I'm not sure that this is the best time to be looking at planning policies. The core strategy is a process that has been ongoing for a significant period of time already. We're reaching the end of that process now. And as I say, it's likely that a public inquiry will be held later this year, certainly not before the autumn, I wouldn't have thought. But that is the correct forum to test new planning policies, revised planning policies, and to revoke old planning policies as we move forward.
And lastly, I think, Mr.
Chair, I'm just concerned that by waiting for it to be routinely removed and not properly representing the planning committee's disapproval, is it possible? Is there any way in which we can, I don't know, make our point very strongly, or what is the process of us actually taking steps to mention? I appreciate that it's an extraordinary service.
We did it for housing, so I don't know if that's because we will look at housing policy.
I think in order to sort of draw this debate to a close at this meeting, we'll take further advice from our colleagues in planning policy who are dealing with planning policies and see whether or not there is a process to deal with SPD 4 before the examination in public.
Can we have a bit of an update on that? Is that all right for everybody in the room? That will go to next and we have some sort of questions.
As I put flashing cattle across the room, what we've been doing for housing, I'm assuming that came from cabinet. So, presumably, the cabinet member responsibility for planning policy can also take a course to the cabinet that invokes SPD 4 and that can go to council. Now, I don't know what more we can suggest because at the moment, planning officer Matthew draws us back to the process that we're in, which is the future policy process. That's not what I'm talking about at all. I'm talking about the existing policy that I regard to be revoked. I wasn't, as it turns out, favoured of the housing one being revoked, but the council votes it, there you go. You've got the limits.
The information we've got now is that if we're going to do it, let's do it correctly.
Absolutely.
And so we'll discuss this again, so we'll go on to the agenda in some form, even if it's under any other business for the next meeting, it'll be on the agenda now. So do you want other items?
I'm so sorry. Wait. Can I?
Yeah.
What's my
issue?
That's the one
I'm asking. Yeah, we can't.
Yeah, could.
What we've decided to do now is it's been minuted.
Yeah.
All the objections have been minuted, and we're going to go away. We're going to find out exactly what the process would be to take this forward, and there's going to be